Morning, and welcome to online worship here at All Saints Episcopal Church in Wolfboro, New Hampshire. We are so thankful that you have chosen to join us as the people of God, the Church of God, alive and well in His strength and courage in these days of tension and threat and temptation to be despairing. We're thankful to be together in this way, and we welcome our brother, friend, and fellow parishioner, Bob Parker, who has gifted us with a beautiful and lovely rendition of In the Bleak Midwinter.
In the bleak midwinter, frosty wind made moan. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow on snow had fallen, snow on snow. In the bleak midwinter, long, long ago, heaven cannot hold him, nor earth sustain. Heaven and earth shall flee away when he comes to reign. In the bleak midwinter, a stable place sufficed. Lord God Almighty, Jesus Christ, angels and archangels may have gathered there. Cherubim and seraphim throng the air. But his mother only in her maiden bliss worshipped the beloved with a kiss. What then can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. What I can, I give him, give my heart.
Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are known, all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God, now and forever.
Amen. In our opening lesson, we hear how Samuel learns that it is the Lord who is calling him to make God's prophet. Three times the boy Samuel misunderstands and thinks that it is his mentor Eli summoning him during the night. Finally, Eli realizes it must be the Lord and tells Samuel to be ready. In the morning, Samuel informs Eli of the punishment that is about to come upon his house. As Samuel grows, all Israel recognizes that he has been chosen by God to prophesy to the people. A reading from the first book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days, and visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel!" And he said, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning, and then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 139. Lord, you have searched me out and known me.
You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my journeys and my resting places,
and are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips,
but you, O Lord, know it all together.
You press upon me behind and before,
and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me.
It is so high that I cannot attain to it.
For you yourself created my inmost parts.
You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made.
Your works are wonderful, and I know it well.
My body was not hidden from you
while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb, all of them were written in your book.
They were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them.
How deep I find your thoughts, O God.
How great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand.
To count them all, my lifespan would be like yours.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are beneficial. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food. And God will destroy both one and the other. The body is meant not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Should I therefore take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that whoever is united to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For it is said, the two shall be one flesh, but anyone united to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Shun fornication. Every sin that a person commits is outside the body, but the fornicator sins against the body itself. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him, about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Before I start, just a note that the sermon today contains some sensitive conversation around the topic of abuse. Let us pray. O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust and untruths twist our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. This week, I've been reminded of two great Americans from the last century. My former United States Senator from New York, who was a politician, sociologist, and diplomat. And a theologian who was both an ethicist and a commentator on politics and public affairs. Daniel Patrick Moynihan famously said, "In a thriving democracy, everyone is entitled to their own opinions, but not their own facts." And it was Reinhold Niebuhr who struggled with the contrast between moral individual and immoral society who said, "Our capacity for justice makes democracy possible, but our inclination to injustice makes democracy necessary." Beloveds, today we lament. We long for and desperately need truth and justice. Truth and justice during this week of Christian unity. Truth and justice during this week that has Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Truth and justice during this week when we will inaugurate the 46th President of the United States. These events reflect the reality of our sin and brokenness as individuals and as a nation. They reflect our hopes and dreams as we strive in love for truth and justice. We strive so much. We strive for unity, even as images of Jesus were carried during the insurrection. Articles of faith used as vehicles of violence. We strive for racial justice and civil rights, even as white supremacists are threatening continued violence in our capital and in houses of worship this very morning. And we strive for a peaceable transition of power, even while we are still shaken by the outgoing president's words, "We will never give up. If you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore." Or by his son's call, "We're coming for you." And by his New York City lawyer's cry, "Trial by combat." Jesus says the truth will set you free. And modern mystic Father Richard Rohr adds that before it sets you free, it tends to make you miserable. This week, Episcopal Bishop Jake Owensby offered that Jesus and Rohr remind us that truth liberates us from the confines of a narrow heart and a misguided mind. And that before we're able to feel the relief of newfound freedom, we will experience the disorientation and the anxiety of letting go of our habitual way of making sense of things. It's hard, though. It's hard to make sense of the truth and trauma that we have experienced individually and as a nation. But in the midst of this, we can find comfort amidst discomfort. We can orient ourselves no matter how shell-shocked. and we can experience the abiding love of God present in all of our beginnings, who knows all of our ways, and who is woven into the depth of all things, even when truth is elusive, even when we are lied to and led astray. You see, God understands our struggles and intimately feels the abuse that we experience. Nothing is hidden from God. God, who knows the truth about us. God, who knows about abusers of power. And God, who knows about our imperfect union. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. This is the interrelated structure of reality." The interrelated structure of reality. And our reality is that our nation has experienced an abusive relationship with classic gaslighters for the last 4 years. We have heard the president say, "What you're seeing and what you're reading is not happening." And that lawyer of his say, "Truth isn't truth." Classic gaslighting statements, telling victims that others are crazy and lying, that the gaslighter is the only source for true information, causing victims to question reality, becoming dependent on the gaslighter for that truth. And the truth is that this gaslighting has been used at the highest level of our government. Let me walk through the cycle of abuse to help us understand this better. In the first phase of abuse, tensions build. There is a breakdown of communication. The victim becomes fearful and feels the need to placate the abuser. In the second phase, there is an incident of abuse, verbal, physical, or emotional. The victim experiences anger, blame, arguments, threats, and is intimidated. In the third phase, there is an attempt at reconciliation. The abuser may apologize or just move on, give excuses after excuses, blame the victim, deny that the abuse even happened, or says that it wasn't as bad as you think it really was. In the fourth phase, there is a quiet period. There is a sense of calm. The incident isn't spoken about, and so it's forgotten. No abuse goes on. Some refer to this as a honeymoon phase. And the cycle continues. For those that have been in abusive relationships, this is all too familiar. And if you have not considered yourself in an abusive relationship before, we have collectively been in one for 4 years. It's why we felt disoriented. It's why the anger has built within us. It's why we may have experienced fear or just wished it all away or said, "Well, yeah, that person's not so bad. The situation isn't really as it might appear on the outside of things." Beloveds, we need to be on watch in these coming days. We need to be on watch for the abuser's playbook. Because requests for unity and forgiveness without apology or acknowledgement of the harm done by people of power and privilege is not reconciliation. It will not bring peace for you, no matter how hard you wish it. Be on watch as abusers shift the focus by saying, "Yeah, yeah, yeah, but what about? But what about what this side did or that person said? Trying the big lie of distraction added on to all of the other big lies that we have been experiencing. By saying what about or blaming anyone who doesn't want to make nice, who doesn't want to forgive and especially forget. Beloveds, we are not called to forgive and forget without work and acknowledgement from those who have hurt us individually and as a nation. That's cheap grace. God calls us to justice. To justice, which means reconciliation, where those that need to repent, repent. I've not heard much repentance this week. There is in some corners, especially within the church that has been ignoring what has been going on for far too long. We need to look for true reconciliation. Not just blame the evil of others, but see how that evil has impacted us and even made us react to it in sinful ways. Beloveds, take time this week to be on watch, but to also reflect on the sins of your own and of our own. What has been our part in allowing all of this to happen? This has not, of course, been the way of love, the way of Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. That is where we need to center our lives again, to follow Jesus and to name the truth, to lean into it, and then life comes. Life of peace and justice and hope. This morning, Paul's letter to the Corinthians reminds us that we continue to live in Christ, that we are not set free to do whatever we want, but we are set free to do what God wants us to do. Through the death and the resurrection of Jesus, we are free. We are free to repent, to be reconciled, and to follow in the way, the truth, and the life. We're called to lives where the choices we make and the truths that we speak show and share the real presence of God. We use our own embodiment to embody Him. We do this in church and in community. We do this through the hard work of truth-telling, peace-making, justice-seeking, following repentance, then reconciliation. Beloveds, may you recognize God calling you to follow the example of Jesus and to live the truth in the power of the gospel. And may you understand and identify as a disciple of Jesus, being deepened as a messenger of truth and a bringer of justice, light, and love for a world that lives in darkness, fear, and feels awfully broken this day. May you embody Jesus.
Thank you. darkness of night. I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love.
We profess our faith with the whole church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human.
For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As this week we observe the week of prayer for Christian unity, commemorate Martin Luther King Jr., and inaugurate the new President of the United States, let us offer our laments and petitions to God, responding to each with the words, "In mercy, receive our prayers." O God, we lament the times when our churches have rejected collaboration with your worldwide family of grace. And we pray for your blessing on the Eastern Orthodox, Roman Catholics, Anglicans, Protestants, Evangelicals, and Independents, that all your people will follow your call to discipleship and grow deeper into our unity in Christ. O God, Shepherd of your people, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament the ways that we and our society have misused your earth with selfish or short-sighted actions, and we pray for an increased commitment to the care of your marvelous creation.
O God, Gardener
of the globe, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament the occasions when our government has neglected the needs of the people of America and the calls for international cooperation, and we pray for President-elect Biden, for Vice President-elect Harris, and for all our elected members of Congress, that they fulfill their obligations to uphold and extend the common good. O God, Shield of the Commonwealth, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament the uncontrolled rage and the senseless violence that recently defaced our nation. And we pray that peace reign in our streets, that our capital cities be safe, that all citizens come to accept the new administration, and that a spirit of reconciliation and cooperation mark the next stage of our national life. O God, peacemaker in our land, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament the decades of ethnic injustices and racial prejudice that brought such suffering to many residents of our country. And we pray that you bless the indigenous peoples, descendants of Africans, and all immigrants to this land, and that you form us into a nation in which all are honored in equal measure. O God, Liberator of the oppressed, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament the unspeakable sadness that has been unleashed by the coronavirus here and around the world. And we pray that you bring health to the sick, comfort to the dying, resilience to health workers, resilience to health workers, prompt vaccinations to everyone, and a lasting end to this scourge. O God, physician and nurse, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
We lament also our private sorrows and our hidden fears, and that we pray that as with the boy Samuel, you speak to us in the night of our need. O God, lover of our souls, hear our cries.
In mercy,
receive our prayers. We lament the lives of those who have died in storms, in riots, and in sick beds. We praise you especially for the life and legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. and those we name here before you. And we pray that at the end we join with all the members of your family in your presence. O God, eternal arms of mercy, hear our cries.
In mercy, receive our prayers.
Into your hands, O loving God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God,
you search us and know us.
You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin.
Our own sins and the broken systems that bind us.
We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love.
We distrust those who are not like us.
We exploit the earth and its resources and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone.
Even before the words are on our tongues,
You know them.
Receive them in your divine mercy.
Amen.
How vast is God's grace. Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen.
May the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
A couple brief announcements. We are gathering again on Wednesday for Sacred Sing and for prayers for our nation. I invite you to join us live on Facebook at 6:57 p.m. I hope to see you Wednesday evening. Our community meal program, Dinner Bell, continues on Thursdays with meals to go, and we are in desperate need of volunteers. We need a couple of volunteers to help us take the packaged meals and deliver them to cars in the parking lot. We are doing this masked and following social distance guidelines, and there is information in our e-news from Friday, and if you have any questions, please call me or Pam Doyle. We could use a couple of volunteers to continue that program. We give thanks for the signs of bleak midwinter and those that try and make it not so bleak. So for Bob Parker sharing his gifts and for Joyce Lake sharing them on the altar shelf today, we give thanks. And we take our offering. I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. You may make your offerings, your financial offerings, by dropping them here at church, by going to wolfsaints.com and clicking on the donate button or making arrangements with your bank to send those to us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All honor and praise be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For at this time we celebrate your glory made present in our midst. And the coming of the Magi, the King of all the world, was revealed to the nations. In the waters of baptism, Jesus was revealed as the Christ, the Savior sent to redeem us. In the water made wine, the new creation was revealed at the wedding feast. Poverty was turned to riches, sorrow into joy. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and say our joyful hymn of praise. Holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna
in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine, and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God of promise, you have prepared a banquet for us.
Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
There is a long-standing practice in the Episcopal Church to offer a means for people to receive Holy Communion spiritually when it cannot be received physically. I invite you to pray with me. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul.
Since I cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart.
Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus,
and let me never be separated from you.
May I live in you and you in me, in this life and in the life to come. Amen.
The God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. Be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.